Divine Truth. Name of this presentation is Question and Answer from People in Gothenburg, and it is part of General Discussion Series. It was presented in Gothenburg, Sweden, on the 8th of July, 2012.
Myself and Mary were wondering whether after we finish today, whether you'd like to get up the front and we take a photo of you. Would you mind that? We did this in Greece, and it turned out to be a really lovely photo of everybody there. And it's lovely having the opportunity to see all of your faces together at some point in the future. If you'd like to be involved with that after we finish, then please come up and we'll arrange you somehow. Usually it's very ad hoc, and put you on the stage probably and take a photo. Do it outside? Yeah, that's a good idea. On one of the stairs, maybe the front stairs or something. In the nice sun. It'll be good proof that there is actually sun here. Sorry. Just in Australia, we're just pretty fortunate when it comes to having a lot of sun. Okay, what would you like to ask? Far away. Just need to use the mics, that's good.
Hello. My question is, what advice can you give to pregnant women who, while they're expecting a child, what's the best gift they can give and not to hurt the child?
In terms of not to hurt the child, very good question. Let's look at the answer. So here's the mother and the father of a child. So let's draw the child like this. So even if it's inside of the womb, it's still a little developing son of God or daughter of God, right? So the first thing is for the parents, and this applies to both the parents, to start seeing this gift of God as a child of God, not your own child, but a child of God. Once you start seeing it as God's child, then you can start actually feeling about, what's the best thing for this child, okay? Now, the best thing for the child is that, firstly, it doesn't know itself when it's going to arrive, so it needs to learn about itself. So you need to allow this child to actually learn about itself, all right? Now, while the child's absorbing all of our unhealed emotions as parents, then it's not really learning about itself, is it? So you can see straight away that that's going to require some things of the parents. So we'll talk about what happens with the parents during the process of gestation, before birth, in terms of what we can do. But if we understand the underlying thing too is that the child has free will, and but it doesn't know how to use it. It doesn't know how to use it lovingly, right? So it has no idea. Now, if I'm using my will unlovingly, then that obviously is going to impact upon what the child believes it can do as well. Now, once I start understanding those basic principles, what I can do with the child is I can see that any unhealed emotions or beliefs that I have that are unloving, so we'll put on there unloving, unhealed emotions, beliefs and so forth, that are all a part of my soul. Oops, I just spelled right. What is ever a part of my soul will enter this child automatically. And whatever I release from my soul will be released from the child automatically. So that tells me that the best gift that I can give to my child is to release as much as I possibly can release, even while I'm pregnant. Now, a lot of pregnant women are afraid that their emotional trauma in terms of releasing is going to harm the child. The reality is that the holding on to your emotional trauma will harm the child. The releasing of the emotional trauma will actually help the child. Can you see the difference? So it's very, very important to understand the importance of releasing the emotional trauma that you have or the false beliefs and so forth that you have. Now, I think I haven't checked this battery, but it looks okay. Just reminded myself to do that. So that would be my number one priority if I was a parent of an unborn child in particular. The second thing is obviously things that you do while the child is within the womb will have a much greater effect upon the child than if the child was newly born or, you know, no longer in the womb. Because your feelings are being impressed upon the child to the greatest degree at that particular time. So any unfelt feelings that you choose to keep unfelt, in other words, that you choose to hold on to rather than feeling, the child will be forced into feeling them. Because everyone around you is actually forced into feeling them. But the child, being inside of your body, will be forced into feeling them the most. Right? So one of the most powerful things that a mother can do is to learn to own and feel every emotion she has rather than pushing it down and denying it. So if she feels frightened, feel frightened. If she feels sad, have a cry. If she feels, and this is why a lot of, and in fact, automatically a lot of women feel more emotional while they're pregnant. And the key is to feel, embrace every one of those emotions for yourself rather than trying to shut it down. Does that make sense? This is very, very powerful for your child. But even more powerful, the biggest thing that you can do for your child is that your child, while it's in your womb, cannot receive divine love unless you do. So what that means is that you can actually pray not only for yourself but for your child to have a relationship with God and develop a relationship with God, and pray for your child to have the longing within itself to receive love. And if you do, then your child will receive some. And that will have a big effect on the child. Does that make sense? Because the love entering the child from God is going to have the greatest effect on the child, greater than your love can ever have on the child. Yeah? So this is a gift that every mother can give her child, and not many mothers on the planet do, of course, give that gift to their child. So there are many things that you can do when you're pregnant with a child that can help the child even before the child is born. In addition to those things, the child is capable of learning from the time of conception, right? Because the child has a soul and the soul has a brain. It has a way of remembering things. And so whatever you do with the child and whatever you teach the child can automatically be learnt even while the child is in the womb. So there are many things you can do in that regard. But if you have a resistance to learning, then of course the child will develop a resistance to learning. So you can see that every emotion that the mother has will greatly affect whether the child has a great ability to learn, has a great ability to absorb information and so forth. So there are a tremendous amount of things that you can do for your child while you're pregnant. And my suggestion to all mothers is to embrace all of those particular things. Of course, there are things you can also do to not physically harm the child. So, you know, obviously what you drink and what you eat will also have an effect on the child during pregnancy, because your acceptance of what you eat has an emotional acceptance in the child of the same thing. So if you're eating meat during your pregnancy, then your child is going to automatically accept the eating of meat as a result. Does that make sense? As if that's something that's loving when it's not. And if you drink coffee and stimulants while you're pregnant, which are obviously doctors have, you know, said frequently not to do those kind of things, but if you do, it will affect the child's uptake of those particular stimulants, and the child will actually become addicted to those stimulants while in the womb. And often then we'll have to give up those addictions, those physical addictions, within the first few days of its life, the first few weeks of its life. And that's going to be quite traumatic for the child. Every time you give up an addiction, it's quite traumatic. So naturally, if your child is having to give up one, it's going to be quite emotionally traumatic as well. So anything that you can do to assist the child to enter the world without having any of those addictions, emotional or otherwise, is going to be a great benefit to the child. Does that make sense? Yep. You want to have any further questions about it? I've been general in my response, but yeah. All right. Pleasure.
Yep. I wonder about infant colics. They're very common and science cannot come up with what it is. Colics is
colic,
like,
yep. Yep.
It's, yeah, stomach pain and...
Stomach pain where it can't keep down its food sometimes, can't keep down its, even its mother's milk sometimes, vomited up, projectile.
But it's... And children screaming, they say that it's like having a heart attack. That's how much it hurts.
Yes.
And...
It hurts a lot, yes.
And both my children had it, so it's... I guess it's a message, and I wonder
it
whether
is.
There is
Very
a general...
Good.
Okay.
If the mother has a lot of terror and fear, the child that is unfelt and denied, so it has to be denied, the child will most probably have stomach problems, and including issues like colic and stuff like that. And it's an indication of the mother's denial of her own fear. And so the addiction that covers fears is generally, so if you look at the fear, the addiction that covers fears like that are usually addictions related to safety, control. So that's the areas to start with. Does that make sense? So your addiction to safety, addiction to control. Many times we have fear of pain, physical violence or pain, physical pain. So it's the addiction is to feel secure and have a painless life. We have a very strong fear of pain a lot of times. So we're afraid of pain, and our own fear of pain can create a lot of problems for our children. Children are not naturally afraid of pain. Have you noticed that? Like, you know, they start walking and they're a bit tentative, right? And then bang, they hit their head, have a big cry for a few seconds down to 5 minutes or so. And then they were just in a lot of pain, right? And what do? Wobble back up again and off they go again. They're not afraid of pain. We have learnt to be afraid of pain over a lot of conditioning from our parents and our environment. And as a result of our fear of pain, we then impress the same fear upon our children, and that often causes them to have painful maladies as a result of our own fear of pain. So we need to learn to address our fear of pain that we have. Many people are afraid of pain and afraid of emotional pain, and we need to address those two fears if we're ever going to grow. Okay. So that's the primary emotions that a person could look at if the underlying terror or fear exists. Of course, it indicates if it's to do with feeding in particular, and it's to do with food and feeding, and it's mostly breast milk that the child is ingesting, then it relates very much to the mother rather than the father. Does that make sense? So it relates very much to the mother's emotions rather than the father's. And for all of you mothers, it is a very powerful process for you to engage this process of real responsibility for what's happening to the child, because you will find you'll be able to work through a lot of unloving feelings inside of yourself quite rapidly if you embrace the process as God intended it to be embraced, yes? If the parents were in an at-one-ment condition with God, then any child that was conceived would be conceived, and the term I used to use in the first century was conceived, I before E except after C, without sin. In other words, the emotional injuries of the parents, because if they were at one with God, they would have no emotional injuries. They would have no false belief systems. They would have no unloving belief systems inside of themselves. And so when they conceive a child, the child does not absorb any emotional injury. It doesn't absorb any unloving belief system, doesn't absorb any unlovingness at all. So this child would be conceived then without sin. In other words, it would have no injuries to begin with. So this is in the end, what I hope is that many millions of mothers and fathers can give that gift to their child. You imagine how these children would be born then. It would be just a wonderful thing. Unfortunately, because we have these different emotions, terrors, fears, shame, all these different types of emotions and grief that we need to work our way through, as soon as the child is conceived, its soul starts absorbing the emotions. And as soon as it starts absorbing the emotions, it starts changing its ability to be happy. And this is why, in fact, many children are born crying. Because by the time they've already had now 9 months of exposure to quite unloving emotions, which causes quite a lot of distress for them, emotional distress that they need to work their way through already. And they come out of the womb already starting to work through it as a result of that. It's a big responsibility being a parent, isn't it? If you think about the emotions that are involved and that affect the child. Yeah. Now, of course, any emotion that the parent works through even after the child is born will have a positive effect on the child. Because if the parent releases the emotion even after the child is born, because the child actually was inside of one of the parents and was conceived by both of the parents, there is a high likelihood the child will automatically process their way through the emotion if the parent does. So I have two children. One, my oldest son's 28 years old, and my youngest son is 26 years old. And I find even now, if I process through an emotion, working my way through something, usually within a few days, one of my sons calls me and asks me what I went through or something like that, because he's now going through a very similar thing. So even when your sons and daughters are adults, you can give them a large gift by working your way through specific emotions that you had not previously resolved. And they will automatically feel drawn into resolving those particular things generally. Some of the times, of course, they might be a bit resistive to that. So when they're an adult, they have that choice. But what I've found myself with my two sons is that even if they're a little resistive, sooner or later they get into it anyway. So it's a wonderful gift you can give your children, even if your children are adults. Mm. But it's great to do it when they're very, very young, because it has a lot more powerful effect on the rest of their life. Obviously, if your children are in their 30s and you work your way through something and that relieves them, they've still had, 30 years of having to deal with that particular burden. And once you've released the particular problem that you've had, that relieves them of receiving that problem from you, but it's still a burden that they had to deal with it for 30 years or so. So it's far better if you can do it when they're very, very young, or just before conception would be great. If all of us worked through our gear before we conceived a child, by the time the child was conceived, we'd be very, very clear of the majority of our problems. And if we were, then our child would have very, very few problems and therefore have a great capacity to express itself and to learn without there being any impediments to that process. I need you to use the microphone. And by the way, yelling out something is not a very polite thing from a love perspective. So put up your hand. Thank you. Fire away.
I'm so sorry. I'm so impulsive.
That's okay.
In that case, we would have a lot of old parents if we should wait until we have learned a lot of things and released a lot of feelings and so.
Sorry, I'm not sure what you mean by that.
If you say we should conceive a child after we have learned all the things and released all the feelings and so, we would have a lot of old parents like...
If you release all of your feelings and emotions, you would look about 25 years old, even though you might be 100, so you would still look young.
Yes, that's great. Thank you.
So, at the end of the day, that argument. You see, a lot of the way we argue through a lot of things, unfortunately, is through the way we see things right now. And what we see right now is our reality, but you've got to understand, and this is a talk I gave, just a very brief talk I gave in Adelaide in Australia recently, was about, just for 1 hour, I talked about what's real. What is real? Well, what you see in the world around you right now, from God's perspective, isn't very real. It is a creation of hundreds of thousands of years of humans distance from love. That's what we see around us right now. And it's not real, actually. We can dismantle it more rapidly than we created it if we all choose to love. When you start choosing truth and love, a lot of things that you thought were real turn out to be very false and not real at all. And one of the things that is not real is age. In terms of, when I say age, I'm not talking about counting from 1 to, in my case, 2,000, right, or so. But I'm talking about the age in terms of the age that you appear. It's not real. As you will find out, if you don't believe it now, you will definitely find it out at some point in your future. There are many people in the spirit world who died of old age and who now look 25. But they've had to work their way through a lot of things to do that emotionally, right? And so even age, in terms of old age, wrinkles on the face, you know, decrepit body and all those kind of things, it is not real. It's a figment of our creation in the sense that we have created it, but it's not what God intended us to be, and we can easily destroy what we create. The trouble that we have as mankind is we go and create something like old age, and then you know what we do? We believe it's real. Right? And then by believing it's real, the next generation believes it's real, and they accept it. And then the next generation accepts it, and the next generation accepts it without doing anything about it. And in the end, we have hundreds of generations just accepting that we're all going to grow old and die. I can't understand why you accept that when science itself has proven that there's no need to do it. You know, they're still trying to discover the age gene, you know, the aging gene, the death gene, they call it, right? And they've discovered what genes they feel it is in the body, in the genetic structure, in the genetic code, in the deoxyribonucleic acid, actually, the DNA of your system. They've discovered the genes that they feel are a part of the aging process, but they have no idea why they come into action. Does that make sense? And I'm telling you why they come into action. Because you all believe they should come into action. Does that make sense? And it's not a matter of believing with your head. It's feelings inside of you that create old age, that create the lines on the face, the body decaying and eventually dying, usually within 100 years. Right? Did you know historically that there are some people who lived on Earth who died of old age when they were 20? Yeah, many hundreds, about 100,000 years ago, most people who died were 20 years of age. So why did they die when they were 20? And you die when you might be 70, 80, 90, 100. There's obviously an improvement there. So why was there... During the Dark Ages, most people died usually in their 40s or 50s. Yeah? That's in the last 2,000 years. Why did that happen? There has to be a reason, yes? And why do we live longer now? Now, a lot of people say it's because of medical science, and I can't agree. It's because of condition of the soul. The soul creates everything. So even old age is not real. So we've got to be careful about implying what is, you know, believing things that are real when they're not really real. They're just our creations, and we could easily destroy them as much as we created them. So we created old age by what we choose to do with our soul. We can just as easily destroy old age by what we choose to do with our soul. Does that make sense? Yeah. So you can, when I say destroy old age, I mean I don't mean you go around and murder every old person. I mean that through the actions that you take, your body no longer ages. And eventually, your body just does what it normally should do, which is every 7 years, every single cell in your body should replicate itself perfectly. And it doesn't. But the reality is that you were created to do that every 7 years. Every cell in your body. Now, there are some cells in your body that replicate themselves every month, and there are some cells in your body that replicate themselves every day, and there are actually some cells in your body that replicate themselves every second. Yeah. And your body is constantly losing matter, but it's also constantly manufacturing matter. And you've got to ask yourself the question, why doesn't it do that perfectly when it seems to do it perfectly up until the age of 21 or 22? Why does it not do that perfectly after then? What's going on? And what's going on is our soul is impacting upon the process. Our soul is negatively affecting, its condition of love is negatively affecting the replication process in our bodies. That's what's real. Does that make sense? So we've got to confront reality. A lot of people feel that I don't confront reality. And I'd have to argue differently. But anyway, reality is to me, anything that God created is reality. Anything that man creates, unless it's in harmony with love, in the end will have to be destroyed if we want to become happy. That's my take on life, actually. Anything that God creates is reality. Anything that man creates, unless it's harmonious with love, is not reality, and at some point in the future will have to be destroyed. So do you know our financial system, yes? Well, that's an unreal system. It doesn't work. Many people in the world are starving, so that's proof that it doesn't work. Many people die. Many people die from a lack of, you know, you have a great healthcare system in this country, but there are many other countries that have terrible healthcare systems. Many people die. Many people die before they're born. Many people die after birth, during birth. Many people die all the way through their life, all for all sorts of reasons. And this is all proof that our medical system and our healthcare system and our economic system is all failing. They are all failed systems that we try to keep propped up. But in the end, they're all going to have to go if we're ever going to accept God's reality. How do you feel about that? And sometimes we go, if we've got no money, we think, yeah, it'd be great if the economic system went. But if we've got $100,000 sitting in the bank, we might not think so. You know, if you had a million kroner in the bank, you might be a bit more worried about the economic system failing than if you had nothing. The reality is the economic system is a failure. It is not supporting mankind on this planet, because even if one person is not supported by it, it's not supporting us. So it does need to go. Remember, anything that God creates is reality. Anything that we create at some point in the future will probably need to be removed. Yep. And the key is to voluntarily start that process rather than having it forced upon you at some point through the law of attraction in the future. Unfortunately, for most of us, though, we don't voluntarily start the process, and so what we're going to find over the coming years is that there will be continual problems with financial collapses and all demonstrating that the whole system has to go. Right? And we need to work our way through our emotional response to that. So, you know, when I look at things like old age, so age, I go, yeah, that's not real. That's just, when I say not real, I'm not saying that it's not a personal experience of many people. What I'm saying is that we can just as easily remove it from our lives as accept it, just by going through a process. When I look at sickness, I go, it's not real either. I have had demonstrated to myself over and over again that all I've had to do is work through specific emotions and a particular ailment or sickness that I've had all through my entire life has completely disappeared. So I used to be a chronic asthmatic, for example, and I worked through a group of emotions, completely disappeared. I used to actually, when I was a child, get sick every week on the average, and I was hospitalised on the average every year, and I was actually, during my childhood, I was also, every month, I was generally home from school for at least 1 week. So that's how sick I was. I think I've only had one sickness since Mary's known me. And it was a spirit-involved sickness where I was vomiting because of getting attacked. Because of my fear. So sickness isn't real. It's just, again, something that we accept as real. It's something we can just as easily remove from our life if we go through the process of what God's bringing us. And I could list many other things, you know, that just not real, not real, not real. They're just things we want to believe are real and we accept as real, but they're not really real.
You say about this with fear. When I open up and things happen, which not usually happen around you in the world, and I feel great and I feel this attachment with God, after a while I feel attacked. And I feel a fear who is, you can't describe it, and doors is open and it's around me, a lot of things around me in the environment. And why do I attract that? Why couldn't I be in this love and still grow? Because I feel sometimes I go up too fast and I get so afraid and I destroy for myself. I can't.
Okay, well, let's look at what's happening, shall we? So here's yourself. You have a lovely experience, you know, with God perhaps, and where you feel some love and you feel loved and you feel all those kind of feelings. And then during that process, your condition of love grows. So you become more loving, yes? But the people around you, and in particular the spirits around you, with whom you have specific addictions, they don't want you to grow in love. So what would you do if you didn't want somebody else to do something?
And they do for me.
Exactly. You would scare them or threaten them. You'd threaten, and this is what the spirits often do. They operate between what I call threats and bribes. So when you're doing what they want, they give you nice feelings. Yeah. They support your life. They make it seem like everything's nice and smooth. And then when you're not doing what they want, they threaten you. And if that doesn't work, what they do is they actually do some damage to you and attack you. And that way, by attacking you, they get to enjoy you getting back into this addictive relationship with them. Now, the reality is that until we break this relationship with these spirits, there is going to be this period of times where we feel good and then we get attacked. And then we feel good and get attacked. And unless we break the actual addiction between ourselves and the spirits, then we're not probably going to get out of that cycle. To actually get out of the cycle, we need to break the addiction with the spirits and we need to not listen to their not accept their bribes anymore and not accept their threats anymore and still plough on with our desires, no matter what happens. When we do that, we'll give up the addictions we have with them and they'll be able to attack us less. So through my life, I've had many spirits around me, both male and female spirits around me, who have been very, very used to attacking me every time that I tried to do something that I felt was the right thing to do. Now that I've worked through my own addictions to having people like me, now it doesn't worry me if they don't like me anymore, and so I get far less attacks, And even though the attack numbers have intensified, so I have millions of spirits that are trying to attack me at any one point in time, but I feel happy, even though that's happening, and I don't feel the effects of their attack. Does that make sense?
And you're not... But I mean, when the fear, when you feel the fear, and it's unreal in this world, I mean, the doors open up and it's things flow, and it scared the shit out, and even my friends, and I feel so bad when friends around me also get scared because this is not real. I mean, I know it, and I try to think it out of it, you know, and try to be in love all the time. But when they start to get afraid around people around me, then I get the scary shit out of me.
Yeah, well, let's address some of the addictions here. Firstly, you said that you try. Remember I talked about trying yesterday?
Yes.
And trying means that there's not a change happening in your soul that's automatic. So what I would firstly do, you try to not be afraid. See, I wouldn't do that. What I would do is if my fear is triggered, I would actually feel my afraid. I'd actually let myself tremble and feel the fear that I feel. Because I know and have confidence that every time I feel and release something, the next time the same thing happens, I'll feel better. Does that make sense? And the law of attraction is bringing me these events to help me work through my fear. So this tells me if this thing is happening where they can project rage at you and you accept their rage and go into a lot of fear, that tells me that you are very open to rageful people, and there is something inside of yourself that you need to heal that allows you to be so open to rageful people. Does that make sense? And once you work your way through that, you will not have to try to feel unafraid. You will automatically feel unafraid. Does that make sense?
Thank you very much.
Yep. Okay. Any other questions? Yeah.
For me, it's a lot of evenings when I go to bed, I really could feel in my body a fear.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes I just try to feel it, to just let it be. And sometimes I couldn't stand it. But I have also found out that sometimes when I'm laying on my back and I'm kicking with my legs really hard up in the sky,
mm-hmm.
that makes it go away.
Well, let's look at what's happening again. When you say you feel it and you can't stand it, this is an issue of what I would call acceptance of an emotion. What I find many people doing is, let's draw a line across the board like this. This is what I call the threshold or limit that we place upon our emotion. And here is like, let's say that's sort of pretty even emotionally. And then this is the threshold or limit that we place on our emotion negatively. So we often have a positive limit and a negative limit. Do you understand? To our emotion. So in other words, when we start feeling good, we feel good, but if we feel too good, we don't like it. We feel uncomfortable. Does that make sense? But and then if we start feeling bad, then we feel okay with that, but if we feel too bad, we get uncomfortable and we don't want that either. Now, if you maintain your emotions in these limits, you will never grow. Because these limits are the limits of stagnation that have been placed upon your developed soul by this point in time. And if you accept those limits, you will never grow. You will stay stagnant. Does everyone understand that? If, when a negative emotion comes along, you really allow yourself to feel the full extent of the negative emotion, now you are stretching yourself. You are now growing. Even if that emotion is negative or if it's positive, you are now expanding the threshold or limit of what you can experience emotionally. Now, one of the things that God is always trying to do is to have us expand, to have us grow. Now, that means that we need to learn how to grow in terms of experiencing emotion. We need to learn how to experience more and more intense emotions. Eventually, once we remove all the unloving ones, we'll only be left with intense loving emotions, which would be amazing, wouldn't it? But initially, when we begin this process, we're going to have some negative emotions from our history that we have yet to experience. So what often happened when we were little, if we look at this diagram of what happened when we were little, our parents defined what normal was, and then when we went above what was normal, what do they do? Can you remember times when you were very, very happy as a child and you were ecstatic and you were just beside yourself, and remember what your parents did? So calm down. So your parents are now, what are they doing? They're saying, I'm going to withdraw love from you if you go above that limit. Can you see that's what they really did? So what they did is they enforced, through the withdrawal of love, they enforced that limit. And then when you went into some negative emotion, when you were little, like you started crying or something like that, what happened then? Again, they enforced this limit, didn't they? Sometimes they might have threatened you with punishment. They might have smacked you and said, I'll give you something to cry about if you don't stop crying, or whatever it was that was causing. And they enforced this limit. Can you see that? So what they did was they created these limits, right, of emotional expression. They created those limits because they were the limits that they were comfortable with. Okay? What God's trying to do is expand our soul so that we have greater limits. In other words, in the end, God wants us to have no limits, none at all. Right? So what we want to do is we want to experiment with our limits. Now, the only way you can experiment with your limits is by going beyond the threshold of your pain emotionally. So if your limit to your negative emotional pain is here, you need to allow yourself to go beyond it before you'll expand, your soul will expand its limits. And if your threshold of pleasure is there, you need to allow yourself to go beyond it in order for you to experience an expansion in a positive direction with regard to your limits. And what I find a lot of people doing is they're very, very happy, and in fact, very happy to accept these limits. So as long as they have emotional swings between those limits, they are comfortable. Their personal comfort is very much defined by these limits, unfortunately, that somebody else has placed upon them. But if you're willing to go beyond this point, you're going to find a very big challenge. It's going to be very challenging to go beyond those points initially because you're not used to doing it. You haven't done it for many, many years. Many of us have never done it for 20, 30, 40, 50, 60 years. We've never gone beyond the limits that our parents established by the time we were 7 years of age. And to actually stretch those limits is going to require a quality called courage. You see, if we have some courage and we have some faith that God will support us by when we stretch our limits, and we have some trust that the way God designed us is that we would always be supported, then we will be able to develop this quality courage, and that will enable us to go beyond the limits. So, you know, when you're laying down and you feel the fear coming up in you and you feel like it's getting unbearable, to really grow, you're going to have to go into the unbearable and actually experience it.
A lot of time I could manage to do it, and then it went away. But sometimes I felt that now it's too much. Yeah.
And when you feel now it's too much, that's when you pray and you say, and I know that's just my feeling, but if I pray and go into this, then I know my soul will expand if I allow this process to be engaged. So my suggestion is to never accept these limits that have been placed upon your soul by other people, actually. Never accept these limitations of a positive or negative direction. And it's amazing how many of us will accept a deeper limit negatively, but we're very resistive even to accepting a higher limit positively. But we don't want to be too happy. Why is that? Because we're so afraid of losing that happiness. And so what we do is we try not to be too happy. Right? And that is a major problem if you think about it. If you're ever going to be completely happy all the time, you're going to need to learn how to be too happy. Does that make sense? And we need to do this. But also, we need to be very careful that we're not addicted to that state when we still have many of these things to go through. You see, every single time your parents did this, there was this that was unexperienced. And that has to be felt. And every time your parents did this, there was this that has to be experienced, that's still inside of you, yet to be experienced. And it has to be felt. If you're going to grow, those things have to be felt. That has to be felt as well as that. These are the feelings that are locked up inside of you, that have been sort of frozen inside of you like ice. And they're not yet thawed out, and they can only be thawed out by the embracing of this process that allows you to expand. So what I would suggest is that when you get to those limits, this was the limit, this limit here, this is when you need prayer. This is when you need God to help you trust that you can go beyond this limit without dying. You can go beyond this limit without being hurt. You can go beyond this limit without, you know, losing your mind and all of those kind of things that we are worried about. Yeah. And often we're taught that anybody who's emotional is in the process of losing their mind, yes? Yeah. But the reality is we need to learn to experience these limitations and go beyond them. And if you can have the courage to do that, you'll find a lot of growth, a lot of personal growth will occur in a very short time. If we go...
Well, I experienced twice. I visit two families, and in both cases, the mother were sick. Well, one has coagulation of blood here in the head, mm-hmm. and it's almost a half year. She cannot get rid of that. So I was observing the family,
yep.
and she has two children. And I saw that she's quite focused in giving love to the small one, 6 years old, and the one that's 11. She's treating him very hard, telling him, oh, you must take care of him, you must teach him. So she's not really loving for the 11-year-old son. So this, when
they're
I was
both sons? They're both boys?
Yes.
The 6-year-old and yeah. 11-year-old are both yeah. boys.
Yes. So this, when I saw that difference of giving love, I could suddenly feel that this blood coagulation has to do with the bad treating of that son, because I could feel it in the air.
Which side of her head was it?
Right.
The right hand side.
Right. Yes. So and she went to get better, and I told her, I mean, if you don't give both love, I mean, God is going to treat you how you treat the worst son. That's what you get from God. So if you are not loving for that, loving the oldest,
I cannot
son,
agree with that statement.
Well, that's what I conclude, because in the both cases were mothers, and the other case was the same. It was also a son and a daughter. She yes. was very loving for one and unloving for the other.
Yes.
And then they are asking to get better and get healed of the problems.
Yes.
And I thought my conclusion was God treats you as you treat the son that is you are treating the worst. Does no, if you are that, bad that, with that, no?
That's where you're wrong.
Okay. That's the question.
Can I explain what is right? The reality is God is always loving. Now, if God is always loving, then God is never going to treat her the same way she treats her son. Does that make sense? However, then the question comes, well, why is she getting this problem that she's got? If it's not from God. And this is one of the I feel one of the fallacies of the world is that anything that's harsh in terms of sickness or lack of health comes from God as much as anything that good has come from God. And the reality is this is not true. Anything that is not good does not come from God. Where does it come from? It comes from our soul being out of harmony with love. See, our soul has a choice to be in harmony with love or to be out of harmony with love. In other words, unlove, unloving. Now, every time we make a choice to be loving, then our soul and our body and everything else around us is going to benefit from the choice. Every time we make a choice that's unloving, our soul is going to be completely harmed by our choice. We're going to harm ourselves in this process. So this woman is not being punished by God, or God is not treating her the same way as what she is treating her elder son. However, because she is treating her elder son in an unloving manner, and she has emotional reasons for doing so, which relate to men in her life and in particular relate to her father, okay? As a result of that, she has spirits around her, men spirits, who are influencing her body and harming her in the same way that her father harmed her. And she is taking this harm out on her eldest son. Right? And the reason why she's taking it out on her eldest son and not on the men that are harming her is because she's afraid of those men that are harming her. And so what she does is she picks on somebody who is smaller than her to actually harm, rather than picking on the person who's actually harming her. Many of us do this. We get hurt by somebody, but that person is so strong or big or whatever to us that we don't hurt them in return, but instead we choose a surrogate person to hurt and we hurt them instead. We yell at them instead, we treat them badly instead. It's like the old illustration where a man at work gets the boss at him all the time, all the time, all the time. So while he's at work, he puts up with that, and then he comes home and then he's on his wife all the time, or he's on his children all the time, or he kicks the dog as he walks in the door. You know, taking out his hurt on somebody who will accept it, just like the boss is taking out his hurt on the person who will accept it, right? And this is what is happening in these cases. And unfortunately, when she does that, her soul feels the problem of that and allows this connection with men, and then she gets these problems in her head on the right-hand side, which are all to do with spirit influences from men who are harming her that she's afraid of addressing. And instead, what she's doing is she's acting her hurt out towards another person, her son. Now she is choosing the unloving behavior, and because she is choosing her unloving behavior and her spirit body and her physical body are attached to her soul, then those bodies will start to get illnesses that act out the unloving behavior. Does that make sense? That is the cause of her problems, not God. Right? God loves her through all of that.
What can she do to get rid of the man influence, the spiritual?
Well, she needs to start feeling her grief of what her father in particular has done with her. Right? She needs to feel her grief. And if she's got anger, she of course will have to feel that first, because that's above her grief. And if she's got fear, then she'll have to feel that before her grief about her father. Does that make sense? At the moment, what she's doing is she's denying all of that and taking it all out on her son, right? Which is a very unloving action to take. Yeah. But understand that her physical problems are not God's creation, they are her own.
Oh,
just saying something. Yep.
Yeah, her son now has allergy. He has allergy in his eyes.
Of course. He will build up through her attack. She is attacking him constantly. And through her attack, he will build up grief that he is not allowed to experience. And because he's not allowed to experience, his body will start actually expressing the grief through allergic reactions. All allergic reactions are related to childhood grief related generally to the opposite gender parent, but sometimes the same gender parent. So grief is associated with crying, this person needs to do, about how his mum is treating him, that she is unwilling, she's of course unwilling to stop it as well, which is a very harsh grief, isn't it? To actually feel attacked constantly without parent willing to stop that. That's very, very damaging. And he will have a build-up of grief so much so that he will have so much allergies that he won't know what to do with them. He'll take antihistamines and all those kind of things in his later life and still can't clear away these allergies until he allows himself to cry about how his mother has treated him. But these are all the results of her unloving choices. Yes? And this is the problem with many of our choices. We make unloving choices. We create all sorts of sicknesses for ourselves, but also for all of the people that we treat unlovingly. It's very, very damaging to everyone. Yeah. Corolla? If we go Corolla and then in front of Corolla. Yeah. So if we go there and then in front. Yeah.
I'm a little afraid of what you're going to answer, but I have this...
Can I first ask you why you're afraid of what I'm going to answer?
Because I have some... events in my life that's not so good, and I have make them myself, or I want them to be in my life.
Well, can I suggest this first, that truth is always beautiful. So why would you ever be afraid of it?
I don't know the truth about... I can say what it is. I have been since you left.
I'm not going to let you say yet until you answer this question. You see, Karala, if we're asking a question and we're already afraid of the answer, then we're going to be a lot more in opposition to receiving the answer. Can you see that? Our fear of an answer causes to not desire one.
Okay.
Yep. And so we need to be very careful of that because God's always trying to tell us the truth and give us answers, but if we're afraid of them, how can he give them? He can't.
But I wasn't so afraid that I didn't want to ask.
Now you're splitting hairs with me.
So I have tried to ask this, but I decided to do it now. But
no, go ahead. Go ahead and ask. That's
because
fine.
I have been involved in death and funeral.
When you say you've been involved, what do you mean?
Yes, it's not my nearest, but I'm close to this. It's three person that has suddenly died.
Yeah.
And it's only in 2 months.
Yeah.
And
you've got other friends that are quite sick as well?
Sorry?
You've got other friends that are quite sick as well?
No, quite. I don't understand.
Proceed anyway. Yes. We'll address that issue too.
Yes. Yeah, okay. I didn't... yes. Yep. And I had have people that is operated.
Mm-hmm.
And... And Johan is my friend, and
mm-hmm.
and I've been sick in my throat.
Mm-hmm.
And I think I come to, in the funeral, I come to the fear.
Mm-hmm.
And then I don't feel it's my, I don't know.
Can I suggest that I know what you're asking, even if you're not, really know what you're asking.
I don't know,
so let's
what
go
I'm
ahead.
Asking.
Let's go ahead and answer some of it.
I'm just talking around, but
and then we can talk about it as we go. And the congestion that you have around your throat area is about your suppression of grief. You are being very, very resistive to grief. You don't let yourself cry about the loss that you feel of these friends. You're constantly trying, in fact, you're constantly trying to prevent their death.
Yes, when they go over, I feel a responsibility.
Exactly.
When they are there. And I talk to them there.
Yes.
And they are so lonely.
Yes, but let's point out firstly that this is you here. When these people are alive, you already feel responsible for them, yes? Don't you? You already feel responsible to help them, don't you?
Yeah, two of them.
Yes. So there is already a degree of a feeling of responsibility for their welfare. Who created their welfare? Who created it? Who created how they feel and what they create?
Themselves.
They did, okay. So they created their own life. Agreed?
Yes.
Therefore, whatever is happening in their life, including their own death, they also had a part, they had a part in the creation of it, yes? Can you see that?
Yes.
Are you sure you can see that?
Yeah.
Yes. So then why do you feel responsible if you can see that?
I felt before that they die, they asked me and talked to me a lot, and I had dreams about them.
Yeah.
And oh. And
but can you see that when you take responsibility for somebody, for what they create, they automatically will start treating you as if you are responsible for what they created? Can you see that? See, there's your addiction. You can't see that.
No.
Yes. You see, this is the problem with our addictions, is that it's like, what's that? What's that? I don't get that one at all. This is how, and I'm not making fun of you here, Carol. I'm saying this is what every one of us need to realise. Whenever the addiction is presented to us, it's like blind. We can't even see what's going on. But in reality, every time I take responsibility for you, I am teaching you that it's okay for you to feel that I'm responsible.
But I thought I was good at letting people have responsibility for themselves.
No, you're not. This is proof.
Okay.
This is your addiction that you would want to believe. You want to believe that. But you do take responsibility for what's happening in other people's lives. And in a way, you get an addiction met through this. So what are the feelings you get met through this? If they respond positively, how do you feel? So when you do something for another person and they respond positively, how do you feel about yourself then? Good?
I don't know. It's spinning in my head.
Yeah, see, now what's
that? I think it's true that I like when people... No. When people need me in...
Yes, this is what I'm saying.
Maybe that's...
This is what I'm saying. It's interesting, the spirits with you are even trying to now shut down you even contemplating that. That they're actually causing you some intellectual distress and causing you to not even be able to think clearly about what I'm saying to you. Does that make sense?
Yes,
there's all this talk now going on. Because you have a group of women spirits with you who do the same thing. This is how they believe everyone should live their life. You do things for others, and you get nice feelings back, and that's great. That's how they live their life, and that's how they feel you should live your life. And what I'm saying is that the events that are created around you are a part of your attraction. So if you've had three people who are your friends die in 2 months, that's quite a lot of people who die in a short period of time around you who you felt responsible for. And this is showing you, actually, that you're not responsible for them, but you're unwilling to give it up because you get a nice feeling back when you take responsibility and they like it. So when you take responsibility and they like you taking responsibility, you get to feel important. You get to feel like you're worthy. You get to feel like you're worth something and you're needed. These are all feelings that cover over the lower feelings, which are, I'm not needed, I'm not worthy, I'm not important. And those feelings that you get from these other people help cover over those feelings you actually have inside of yourself. Does that make sense?
Yes.
And so what we do is we enter an addiction with a person, but unfortunately what happens is they enter into a corresponding codependency with us. So when you take responsibility for them in their life now, when they pass, they think that you should still be responsible for where they arrived.
Yes.
But they created where they arrived, not you, you see. They created it. But they're trying to make you responsible for it still. They need to take responsibility for the fact that if they passed and they passed into a place that's not happy, that that's their creation. Just like their own death was their creation, just like many other things were their creation through their entire life. And this is the thing that they need to understand. Every time they put the responsibility on you and you accept it, both of you don't have the ability to grow out of the situation. So you've got to start addressing this addiction that's present, that's causing you to take responsibility for other people's lives. Does that make sense? And you'll find, once you start addressing that addiction, you'll find there's a lot of emotion in it of wanting their approval, wanting to feel worth, getting a feeling of worth out of helping other people all the time, even if your own life is not happy, you get a feeling of happiness from the other person. And this is the addiction. And that's the addiction you need to begin to confront. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Yeah? Yeah. And if you allow that addiction to be confronted, what you will find is you'll be able to better assist the people who have passed, because you'll be able to talk to them about why they attracted the condition they're in. At the moment, you feel responsible for the condition they're in, so it's very, very hard for you to talk honestly about why they arrived in that condition. See, if I'm feeling responsible for you and something bad happens to you, then I'll feel like I'm partly to blame for what happened to you, mm-hmm. if I feel responsible.
Yes, because I feel that they need help. And
put the mic up a bit closer. Oh,
yeah. I feel that they need help and they contact me from... and it's... they're saying it's really hard to work the way up.
It is
over there. It's much more easier here, and they are sorry that they didn't do it here.
Well, I don't know if I could agree with that.
No?
Because the reality is that it's one thing to have sorrow in retrospection, quite another to have a truthful feeling of sorrow. So in other words, what they're doing is they're arriving in the spirit world, noticing their condition for the first time when they had plenty of opportunities when they were on earth to notice their condition, and they kept a blind eye to it all. Now that they notice their condition, they say it's hard to progress in the spirit world, but the reality is it's just the same here or there. They have to notice their condition first before they can progress. And they didn't realize their condition on purpose. They chose to avoid how they really were. That's the reality. Now we can present that reality to them, but if I feel responsible for their reality, then I'm going to even probably back off telling them the truth about how they created their own reality in the spirit world. And this is what you need to be careful of doing yourself. Every time you take responsibility for them, you are causing them to put responsibility on your shoulders. And that is not helping them. They need to see that they are responsible for what they created, and where they've arrived in the spirit world is the direct result of their own creation, not yours.
So that's why I had this throat.
No, ache. The reason why you have your throat is, as I pointed out at the beginning, you have a lot of grief to feel. That you are suppressing. You have a lot of grief to feel about the death of loved ones. And this is about the emotion of loss that you do not want to feel, which is a very separate issue to the other issue of taking responsibility. Does that make sense?
Yeah, yeah.
When you suppress grief in your head, you will suppress it. You usually either suppress it here or here. Now, here, it will affect your heart. So this is why people have heart attacks when they suppress their grief in this region, don't allow themselves to feel their grief with their heart, they will feel it here. You let yourself feel your grief with your heart, but you do not let yourself experience it. You don't let yourself voice your grief. And this will congest you here.
How do I do that?
By having a good cry regularly and letting yourself have a good cry regularly. But to do that, you know what? You'll have to give up an addiction. Because, you see, when you cry, you can't go and help somebody else.
No.
And that's the problem, you see. You want to go and help somebody else so that you feel happy. And if you cry, you can't go and help somebody else because you're too busy crying. So... So this is another, can you see the cycle of what happens? It's like, I know I've got to cry, I've got grief, I know I've got to cry, but I want to help the other person so I can feel happy. But to be happy, really, you're going to have to cry. You let go of the grief. And it's the grief of loss that is caught up all in here. Yeah?
Thank you.
It's my pleasure. Let's come forward with the mic. It's not working now. Can we have the second mic? And we just need to check the battery. Is it working? Can you just talk into that
Hello?
For me, Anna?
Hello?
Oh, that's working. Yeah. Okay.
Now this is working.
That's all fine. That's fine. Yep.
I'm thinking about having children or not. Because for some reason, if I have try to have a child, I feel guilty about that I have not released all my fears and... I don't want injure my child.
That's fantastic that you don't want to injure your child. Mm. However, can I just suggest one thing about the guilt? Yeah. There are really only there's only really one good reason for having a child. What do you think that might be?
To feel love.
Yes, to share your or my love with them, yes? That's only one good reason to have a child, yes? When you're afraid that your condition will impact it on a child, what emotion are you sharing now? You're sharing fear now, aren't you?
Yes.
Can you see that? You're not sharing love, you're sharing fear. You see, this is where we have to be very careful. It's one thing to recognise our own condition. It's quite another to judge it and be afraid of it. Do you see the difference? You see, it's very important to recognise our own condition because when we recognise our own condition, we can change. But if we judge our condition or are afraid of our condition and the harm it may cause, now it's highly unlikely we're going to be completely open to change. Do you understand?
Yes, I think so. If I really... truly want to change and grow.
Then your child is going to be a wonderful child,
yes,
and benefit from their life and experience with you. If you lock up your emotions and particularly lock up this fear that you have and your guilt that you have and you lock those emotions up, now any child you might have will definitely not be benefited from sharing their time with you. Does that make sense? So this is where we have to be so careful. We have to still see ourselves truthfully. So it's like looking at ourselves in a mirror, going, that's not very good, right? And at the same time go, even though it's not very good, you have the ability to change. You have the ability to grow. And you have the ability to have a sincere, pure desire in your heart to do those things. And as long as you have the ability to do those things, why not embrace your life? And if embracing your life means having a child, go and have one, right? And if embracing your life means traveling the world, go and do that. If embracing your life, you know, whatever embracing your life means, embracing your desires means, then go and do that. Does that make sense? Allow yourself to do that. Don't lock down your desires for the sake of this emotion. Does that make sense? Because whenever you do that, you finish up locking up yourself. You lock up your soul. You're stagnating your soul automatically. And if you do finish up having a child in that state, that is far more damaging to the child than being in the other state. Do you see that? Yeah. So I, if it was me and I desperately wanted to have a child, I'd have to have a look at the desperation, because that obviously is an emotion. And I'd have to think, well, you know, if I desperately want something, then there's obviously something going on there. But if I want the child to share my love with the child, not for getting anything from the child, then that's a very pure desire. So why would you not embrace it? You're always going to learn from that kind of desire, always. Yes. So allow yourself to embrace your pure desires without fear. Understand that there are still, you know, imperfections in the reflection, that you, when you look at the mirror, you see yourself and you can see this work that needs to be done. Do the work as it comes up. Teach your child how to do the work as it comes up by doing the work yourself as it comes up. But embrace life. Don't shy away from life and reject life just because you're afraid that it might damage something, or you're afraid that you might actually make a mistake, or you're afraid that you might hurt somebody, or any of those other reasons. If you have a sincere desire to love, then you'll automatically address those other reasons as they come up. Anything that's unloving, you'll automatically address. Yeah?
Thank you.
Does that help?
Yes, a lot.
If you just come straight in front of you.
Okay, my question is about anger.
If you put the microphone a bit closer.
My question is about anger.
Good on you, yep.
I had a very angry father.
Yes.
It was a lot of anger.
Yep.
And as you were talking, I just realized that I believe I'm still angry at my father.
Yep. And that is true.
Yes, because I guess I could not never told him that I was angry.
Yes. Yep. He would have been too scary if you told him, wouldn't he?
Probably.
Yeah.
But I show it to him.
Yes, I agree. Yep.
So.
And you get away with that because the words, he goes, oh, there's no words yet. So that's, he almost puts up with that, yes?
Yes. And I thought, I worked through this. Mm-hmm. And I thought I'd forgiven him. But now, I don't think so.
Oh, I agree.
Uh-huh. So, what you're saying is, I have to grieve that.
Yes.
That I didn't feel loved.
Well, there's quite a lot that you didn't feel. Shall we go through some of the things
all
that
right.
you didn't feel?
Yes, please.
Yep. So, if we start firstly, the best place to start when we have issues with our parents is to think of our parent and write down a list of how they treated us that distressed us. Everything that caused us to feel hurt, either physically or emotionally. And usually, and many times, it is a combination of both. So my suggestion first is to make the list of hurt with them that you feel.
Okay.
Yes?
Yes.
When you make a list of hurt, you will actually finish up coming up with events in your life, in your childhood generally, where they hurt you. And in fact, many times they repeat that hurt over and over again. So even right now, your father has a tendency to hurt you still. And through
other people?
And also through his feelings towards you that you are still open to receiving. So even if you don't spend much time with him, you're still receiving his feelings about you.
But he's gone.
Yes, I know.
Okay.
Yeah, you're still feeling his feelings about you.
All right.
So he's there in the spirit world. He's not gone.
No, he's not. He's right.
He's still alive.
You're correct.
Yeah, and you're still feeling his feelings about you.
What I meant is he's not on earth.
He's not here with me.
All yep. right.
So I would make a list of the hurt. Now, your father does not want you to do that, of course.
Oh, he doesn't.
No parent does.
All right.
Generally. How many parents go, yes, please make a list of all the ways I've hurt you?
Okay.
Not, it takes a very good parent to do that, right? And so, but the truth is that it would be very beneficial for all of us to make such a list. Even the parents who have hurt us need to make such a list with their parents, yes? So we make a list of the hurt. Then we need to feel about this hurt. We need to feel about it. And
but there's going to be a lot of hurts, right? So
yeah,
I need
yeah.
to feel every single hurt.
Yeah, yeah. Whoa, she says. Yeah.
I didn't say the word.
No, but it felt the word. Whoa. I have to do that. Whoa. and yes, that is the case. Because you want to heal it, don't you?
Yes, I do.
Yes. So of course, to heal it, you have to feel it. It's quite simple. But let me say a few things about it. It's important to understand that the parent, in this case your father, hurt you. Sometimes he hurt you on purpose. Sometimes he hurt you because he didn't know any other way of acting, because he was hurt by his own parents and hurt you in a similar way. But he does have to take responsibility. At some point in the future, in his spirit life, he will have to take responsibility for the hurt that he has created. He will. However, I'll put this to you. Here is you, and this man has hurt you. Now, this hurt now has a ball of grief inside of you, right? So there's a lot of tears about how he's treated you. But you've been very afraid to express these tears for a number of reasons. One is that you feel there's a lot of them and you feel that you'll be crying a long time.
Yes, that's right? Correct.
So you're very afraid to actually embrace the process to even start it, because you feel that if you start it, you're afraid that it might not end, right? that it will go on for too long a time. Right? So there's a fear about the grief itself. There is also, in your father, he created this fear of you expressing your grief. Because when you expressed your grief, he humiliated you with your grief. Do you understand what I'm saying to you?
I don't remember that, but probably.
Well, he made you feel that your grief was weak, right? And therefore, something that he could even oppress even further. And so you learnt to be very rigid with your grief. You learnt that crying finished up getting more crying. And so what happened inside of you was you decided you're not going to cry about it. You've just decided, that's it, not going to cry about it. And in doing that, you actually treated yourself quite harshly and suppressed the grief. Do you understand?
Yes.
And in the process of suppressing this grief now has a layer of fear about it, that you're very afraid to experience it. Yes? And you're afraid to experience it because of your father's treatment of you, but also because you learnt to tough it out, to be strong. And you're afraid that if you go into your grief, you'll become weak.
Yes, and I have to be responsible. I wanted to be responsible for my brothers and sister.
Yes, you felt you had to be strong for everyone
for
else.
Them, yes.
Yes.
Including my parents.
Yes. Yeah, including your parents. Yes, I agree. And so you have this layer of fear associated with your grief as well. Now these two things are the things that will help you. Now, can I just put to you?
Yes.
Here's your dad, he has hurt you. If you wait until he is sorry, you're going to be waiting a long time before you're happy. Do you understand?
I totally understand.
Yeah. He was never sorry the entire time he was on earth, right? And by the way, he is still not sorry.
He never let me know, so I just have to assume that he wasn't.
Yeah, he's not sorry, and he's still not sorry.
Oh, wow.
Right now. Right? So wow. I can feel what he feels, and he's still not sorry.
All right.
Now, if you wait for him to be sorry, you'll be waiting a long time before you forgive him.
Wow.
To actually forgive him, you have to experience the grief he created.
All right.
Does that make sense?
Yes.
And you're not forgiving him for him. You're forgiving him so that you can have a happy life.
Yes.
Do you understand?
I understand that about forgiving. Yes.
Yeah. And if you allow yourself to go through this process of feeling this grief and allow yourself to deal with the fears that you have above your grief, you'll actually come to a point where you no longer feel hard towards your father. And in fact, you'll actually come to a point where you feel some compassion for him. But you will not tolerate bad behavior from him anymore either.
Or other men.
Or other men. Yep, any man. Does that make sense?
That's what I think I need to resolve.
Of course.
Very much.
Because if you do, if you don't resolve this grief, what you'll finish up attracting is men into your life who are willing to hurt you.
Yes.
And you'll be willing to accept their hurt just like you feel you have to accept the hurt from your father.
Yes.
And until you grieve it, you will keep accepting it.
And I'm concerned about my daughter too.
Yes.
Because it's a chain, so she will...
Of course. She will have the same problem.
She's better than me, yep. But...
But she will have the same problem with men.
Yes.
Yep, exactly the same issue. And so you can help her by going through the issue yourself too.
Yes, I understand that yep. I can help.
That's very
now,
good.
Now, one more question. Okay, I have this idea from other teacher that I have,
mm-hmm.
that when you ask for something, you have to be very specific. So when you say, ask God or pray to God, I'm a little bit concerned that I might not know how am I going to ask because I'm not clear. Does that really matter? Because I think thinking about it, God really knows what I want, even if I cannot.
Yep.
Even if I'm not clear, am I correct about this?
I agree. Firstly, God already knows. So you're not... So we'll just write that down. God already knows. So if you are if you are specific, who will it help? Does it help God?
No. What I'm saying is, if I want help with something, I understood from another teacher that I have to be very specific.
Yes, I understand the question. I'm right. Asking you another question, which is involved in that question. If you are specific, who does it help? God or you?
Me.
Yes. So there is a benefit to being specific in the sense that you have to know yourself.
Yes.
Does that make sense?
Yes.
So I agree there is a benefit to being specific in the sense that you need to know yourself. But there are times you don't know yourself. So you know what the best thing to do really with God is? Is before you be specific, you need to be honest. Does that make sense?
Okay.
So if I was honest, I'd go... Yeah, I've got really no idea what the problem is, right? So you say to God, look, God, I've clearly got no idea what the problem is, right? I'm just totally clueless as to what's caused this. And can you bring me an event that shows me what's caused this problem? Does that make sense?
Yes.
Now, that's being honest. And if you be honest before you're specific, you'll end up having exposed what the problem is and then you can be specific. Does that make sense? Then you can pray about that particular problem. But if you don't know what the problem is, how can you be specific? You can't. You have to be honest, though, in the sense of, do you really want to resolve it? Do you really want help with it? And do you really want to know what it is? And be honest that you don't have a clue and tell God that. And because the honesty is what God is looking for first. The truthfulness, the sincerity. That's the qualities that God honors every time.
All right.
Every time.
Thank you so much. This helps me a lot.
It's a pleasure. It's a pleasure. Any other questions? Come down. It's great, by the way, having your questions. Yeah. It's my pleasure.
To continue on this, having problem with men.
Yep.
I can see that in my life too. Is that always related to my father?
Can we be specific? What kind of problems with men are you having?
What I'm thinking about is a man who is hurting me, and I'm letting him hurting me.
So you accept hurt from a male.
Yes.
What do you define as hurt?
Don't being respectful, don't taking own responsibility.
So he's not respectful.
saying things to me which is...
Can I just stop you for a sec? Yes. I'll just write some of these down. So not respectful, when you say not taking responsibility, does that mean he expects you to cook for him and clean for him and all those things?
Yeah, or pay for him or...
So he basically expects you to take responsibility for his whole life, okay? So he's not taking responsibility, yeah?
Mm-hmm. And he's projecting a lot of his inner feelings on me.
What inner feelings? Can you be specific?
Anger.
Anger, so he's being angry.
And today you learned, Ella told that we could just leave if someone is angry.
Yes.
But I have stayed.
Yeah, if you love them, you will leave them for a bit, and then you'll say, then you'll see in a month's time whether he's still angry, and if he's still angry, then stay away. and if he's in 2 months' time, he's still angry, then stay away. Mm-hmm. And then eventually he'll soften up, hopefully, and work through his anger, and eventually he's very sorry for his anger, and you say, that's the time I can go back.
Now that's happened all the time. So. Yeah.
But obviously if it's happened a lot of times, then he hasn't been sincere with his...
Not on the deeper level.
Exactly.
He's growing a lot, but not on this level, which I think my soul want to live on.
Yep.
So now I'm wondering.
Let's proceed with the list of problems. Let's just call it with the man, right? Mm. So can we continue? The other main problems.
There is a lot of problem, but there was a blank.
Okay. You can't remember the list now.
No. Or I don't want to.
Can I suggest it's because you're a bit afraid of what I might say about the problems? But
I really want you to tell me, and I feel that I come really scary for me to say this in this audience, because there is a lot of people who know who I'm talking about.
Right, yes. So I understand that. And the key for us here is to understand it's very, very, very good for every single person in the world to be completely open and honest. Because the beauty of that is that just so many people, including the people involved, learn everything. How do you feel about your husband? Be honest.
I both love him and hate him.
Right. So when you say you feel love for him, what kind of feelings do you feel then? I think she said you both love him and hate him, isn't
yes.
it?
Yes.
Yeah.
There is some very, very... So I can look at him and feel love because there is something.
Yeah.
And...
And when you hate him, how does it feel? What does it feel there? How many people feel like a love-hate relationship with their partner, by the way? I think quite a few would have to put on their hand about that one. Yep.
I love him when he is the good way of who he is.
So when he's more his pure self,
yes.
You feel quite attracted to the man and you feel like, wow, that's a nice man. That's the man I'd like to really be with. And then when he's in this kind of state... Mm-hmm. You start feeling like, well, that's not very nice.
This is not good for me, at least. And I can't let him be who he is. But I'm more concerned about, is that good for me to stay with this?
I agree,
or
yes.
Is it time for me to take next step to come further with my soul?
So you definitely need to address that at some point. Mm-hmm. So I suppose what I'm asking, though, how long have you been together? Do you mind?
12 years.
12, yep. So has it been like this the entire 12 years?
No. It started very lovingly, passionate. I thought it was my... even though I was not thinking about soulmate, but I think
you sort
it
of
was
felt that way.
Yes.
Yep. And when did it start turning out like this? Can you sort of go back to a point when it sort of begun to be like this?
It was about 3 years ago. When he has created a situation which is he's not satisfied with.
So about 3 years ago, you sort of felt a change in the relationship.
Yes.
And that seemed to be triggered by some personal things that happening to his life with regard to work situation and so forth.
Yes.
That's caused him to have obviously poor opinions of himself.
Yes.
That he then acts out with yourself. Because he doesn't want to feel... what's going on. Okay. So you understand the situation quite well, yes? See, the reason why I ask these questions is because it's not because I couldn't have given you some answers sooner. It's just that it's very important to understand the whole situation. See, a lot of people, when they ask me questions like this, they don't understand much of their own situation even. They don't understand what's going on and the feelings that each party is having towards the other. But you seem to have a fairly good grasp about, you know, when it began, what was the trigger. These are very important questions to ask. Okay, so your real issue is the fact that this is now a fairly common occurrence in your relationship where you're no longer respected. He's not taking responsibility for the creations of his own life. He expects you to get him out of these creations. He doesn't want to feel about them. And instead he gets angry. And because he gets angry, often you're on the receiving end of the anger. And so then the question is, well, do I stay with the man or not? Now, I'm not going to tell you to leave your man or to stay with him. Do you understand? I'll just give you some principles about what we need to consider when it comes to love. Firstly, the question when we are dealing with relationships, we really need to ask ourselves four questions. And if you would like to know what those four questions are in detail, on my website, under I think it says Jesus letters, and there's letters that I wrote to different people, and one of those letters, which is also downloadable as PDF. So if you go into, I think it's the third thing down the side, it says downloads. If you click on downloads, you'll find there's books and PDFs, and if you click on that, you'll find a list of different things that I've written and that other people have written. And underneath there, you'll find some called Jesus Letters. And underneath there, there'll be a letter that I where I wrote about relationships. My suggestion is to read that letter, right? In that letter, I made some specific comments about relationships and what needs to exist in order for a loving relationship to continue. And it basically, you can easily turn it into a series of questions to ask yourself about a loving relationship and how you can make a loving relationship or have it continue. Now, the only thing I must point out first is that for a loving relationship to continue where two people stay together, so you can still love somebody and be apart, by the way, as many of you know. Right? So you can love somebody and be apart from them. So what I'm saying here is for the relationship to stay together, it requires the two people to both ask the same four questions, not just one of them. And this is going to be a problem for many people who have a unilateral problem in their relationship, or what they believe to be a unilateral problem in their relationship. Can I also state that there is no such thing as a unilateral problem in a relationship? In other words, there is no such thing as just one person being responsible for the creation of the relationship. Now, can I point this out as your example, if I can give an example and use your example? We have a man who has been loving in the past and had an event happen to him that he does not want to feel about, that's now causing him to act unlovingly to yourself, but also to others, right? We have a woman who has been in a loving relationship in the past, but who is now willing to accept unloving behaviour. Yes? Which is an issue for her, is she not? So, yeah, that's true. So we have a man who had some event happen, so he attracted an event to help him address specific emotions, which he's refusing to address. And instead, what he's doing is he's choosing to be unloving by being in a rage or angry about the situation. And he's projecting that rage at the woman. The woman, who has been in a loving relationship in the past, had an event happen, which was an event, the same event. Do you understand? The same event affected you in the same way, but it's affected you differently, in a different way, but it's the same event that happened. So 3 years ago, the same event happened and this caused this unloving behavior to begin. And you're willing to be unloving to yourself by accepting the rage of your partner, yes? And you're also willing to be unloving towards him because what you're actually doing by accepting his rage is you're teaching him that his rage is okay. And that's not a loving act either. No, it's not loving to teach somebody that. So you're being unloving to him by not acting or not deciding to do something about this situation. And so the question then becomes, what do I do if I am loving? Well, firstly, can you see that I must first love myself? Right? I must do that. But an even more important series of questions we need to ask ourselves is this. And I'll try to remember them and list them off where. Am I open to being loved? In other words, do I want to receive love from another person? Do I have a desire to receive it? And once I have a desire to receive it, am I open to receiving it? There are two different questions really, aren't they? Do I have a desire to receive it? And if I do have a desire to receive it, am I even open to receiving it? A lot of people say to me, look, I really want to be loved. And then I ask them what's happened in the past when they loved and they ran away. Do you really want to be loved then? You're not you say you want to be loved, that's the desire, but if you're not open to receiving the love, then that's a problem, you see. Now, for a love to actually happen between two people, I have to be willing to give love. And I have to want to give it. Not only willing, but want to give that gift of my love, right? And you have to be willing to receive my love for us to have a relationship. Right? And then you would need to be willing to give love and I would have to be willing to receive that love. Does that make sense? And then we have a hope of having a relationship. In addition, I would have to be open to receiving the love, not just be desiring it, but actually open to actually having it. So these are all questions we need to ask. Now, if one party is not open to give love, then straight away the relationship cannot be loving. And if one party is not open to receiving love, then it can't be loving. Now, if any party first addresses their issues, their own issues, so what I would first address in this relationship, before I considered leaving a relationship, I would first address my own unloving behaviour. My own unloving behaviour in this case is that I'm not willing to tell him that his rage is unloving and I need to be willing to tell him that this is unloving behaviour. And I would even say to him, look, I feel the unloving behaviour is because of the event 3 years ago where lost the job or lost the contract or whatever it was that happened, something with business, wasn't it? And that's caused you to feel bad about yourself. And now that you're feeling bad about yourself, you're starting to attack me. And I feel that's the cause, but I don't deserve this attack. I don't deserve this unloving behaviour from you. And I'm telling you now that I don't deserve it. And what I'm also saying to you is if it continues, I have to do something about it. I have to stop the unloving behaviour. The only way that I know of stopping it is leaving you. That's the only way I know of stopping it. So if the behaviour continues, I have to go. And I know that's quite difficult because if you've built up a secure life, you've got a house, you've got cars, you've got all sorts of things in amongst all of that. And it's very, very difficult to address the security issues of that. But at the end of the day, if love does not exist, then the relationship is already gone anyway. Now, you can continue to love the individual and hope that at some point in the future they address this particular problem. And in fact, I would definitely, if it was me and I loved, like if I loved Mary and I wanted her to address the problem. Even if she left for 3 years or 5 years and had 5 relationships in that time, I'd still want her back and I'd still want to love her, but I'd respect the fact that she wants to do those things and that I can't agree to staying with her while she wants to do those things. Does that make sense? But I'd still feel my feelings of love for her. And if I had any hurt, I'd have a cry about it and address the particular emotions that I feel about that. So my suggestion is, firstly, ask him to stop the unloving behaviour. Talk to him about the unloving behaviour. Talk to him about the fact that it is that you believe it's unloving, and also that it's been hurting you. And tell him that you understand its cause. You understand that it's to do with what happened 3 years ago and how he feels about himself about that. But that he needs to address those particular issues. And also that if he's unwilling to, then you cannot see any way to stay together, because to do that would be to harm yourself. But my suggestion is to have a look at that presentation about relationships. We also did a series of videos about human relationships, about love, that I've just only recently put on YouTube. They were done in 2009. But so it's 3 or 4 years ago now, but they've only just been loaded onto YouTube, so that you might benefit from also looking at those. There's a series of talks called Lessons in Love, and then there was one series of talks that I called Human Relationships, Loving a Partner. And I think there were 4 sessions or 3, yeah, I think there's 4 sessions or something of those particular discussions. So my suggestion would be to have a listen to those particular discussions as well. But in particular, have a look at that PDF that's talking about relationships, because it will help you answer the 4 questions. And if he's willing to answer the other 4 questions, the same 4 questions for himself, and willing to begin addressing the issue, then you could have some confidence that the relationship is going to improve. But if he's unwilling to, and I'd say that to him, and then if he's unwilling to address those issues in any way, and he's unwilling to work his way through why he wishes to be angry with you and treat you unlovingly, then of course you need to take some kind of action that would demonstrate a love of yourself. Otherwise you will find your own love of yourself will keep degrading, and you will accept worse and worse and worse treatment, and that's not a very good thing for your life. Yeah. Yep.
Thank you very much.
Pleasure. And if we go over there and then down the front.
We have a question here from Karen that she's written up.
Yep.
And she said that there's someone who's been sitting here by the window and wants her to be aware of him. She wonders who. She has to ask.
A spirit, she means, yes?
Yes.
Yep. I think we've had some similar chats, Karen, about... Has your father is passed, yes? Has he passed?
Yes. Yep.
And he is quite frequently with you?
Yes.
And this spirit here, you don't believe is your father?
No.
Okay. So the question then becomes, what do you feel from him?
Takes a little extra time.
That's okay. I'm willing to take the time. I suppose the question really is, what is the dominant emotion she feels from him? So the dominant emotion you feel from him.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. She's got to do it with her eyes under pressure.
Almost done with the sentence.
It's interesting when I ask the dominant emotion, now Karen's in the emotion, in an emotion, yes?
Yeah.
So this is very good, you see. It's like the beauty of asking about the emotions you receive from somebody is that instantly you start allowing yourself to feel that particular emotion. And this is a very, very powerful thing to do. And can I, while she's just allowing herself to feel about that, can I just show you what happens here? Often what happens is that we ourselves, so this Karen, in this particular case, has attracted a spirit, a male spirit, who's projecting at her an emotion. Now, she wants to ask the question, why is he here? But he's already projecting at her an emotion. And the whole question is because she doesn't necessarily wish to feel the emotion. Do you understand? And as soon as I say, well, what's the emotion that you're feeling from this man? Now there's instant reaction emotionally.
It might be my son. Yeah. It might be my son, she said.
Yes. So can you, and when you say your son, can you be a little more specific? Or maybe Mario, do you know much about Karen's son? Yes. And this is why Karen's feeling some grief. Yeah. Because Karen had an abortion in the past, right? And it's her son, the aborted son, who's with her. So what's the emotion she's feeling from him? She can't describe it because it's actually an emotion of love she's feeling from him, and she feels unworthy of receiving it. Yes? So because when we take an action towards another person that we believe is a harmful action or we have some guilt associated with the harmful action, what we finish up doing is we feel very, very blocked to receiving anything from that person. Because at any time we receive from the person anything, we automatically go into our own guilt. We automatically feel the grief of our own guilt of what we did. And sometimes our spirit friends come to us, including our, you know, people that we have harmed, come to us projecting emotion of love for us, and all we feel is this terrible feeling of guilt and shame about our action, and so we don't want to feel it, right? And we block that off, and then, of course, because we block that off, it almost, we go, oh, who is this person? But the reality is Karen already knew who the person was, right? And already knew the emotion she was getting from him and already knew why she's feeling that emotion, why she feels the way she feels, why she wants to block it. And now she's allowing herself to have a cry about it. She's allowing herself to connect with the emotion itself as to how she feels about what happened. Does that make sense? Does that make sense to you, Karen? Did you hear
yes.
all of that? Yeah.
Yes, it makes sense.
Yeah. So my suggestion, Karen, is just to let yourself feel this guilt, shame and sadness that you have about the abortion and just let yourself have a good cry about it and release it from you. He's okay now and he's projecting some love at you so that you work your way through this issue because he feels this issue is stopping you in your progress.
She's writing something else here.
So while Karen's doing that, can everyone see what happens with our guilt and our shame and other emotions that we do?
He has forgiven.
Yes, he definitely has forgiven. He has feelings of love towards her and he understands, he's had to go through releasing his grief about what happened and what he's trying to do now is help Karen go through her grief about what happened and her feelings of guilt and shame about what happened. So that's what he's attempting to do by contacting you. If we come down, yep. Is that okay?
Yep.
Let's come down to you now.
Yeah, I have a lot of difficulties with my sister and I'm very sad about it.
Mm-hmm.
It had been for many years. She's 8 years younger than me. Mm-hmm. And she many times put her anger on me. Mm-hmm. And blaming me for different things, and I feel that I'm not receiving. It's not correct. She projecting a lot of things on me, yep. And right now I haven't met her for 2 months.
Mm-hmm.
And before we were talking mostly every day,
mm-hmm.
And it was not really. I felt I really it not really was a choice. I could after she was angry at me and she was blaming me and so. So I went in so hardly to my fear. So I couldn't, I stayed in bed. I couldn't really move.
Mm-hmm.
And I couldn't contact her.
Mm-hmm.
And I felt so bad about it. I couldn't even tell her that how I felt.
Mm-hmm. So she was projecting anger at you.
Yeah.
And you became afraid.
Yeah.
Now, can I ask you about your mother?
Yeah, sure.
So how do you feel about your mother?
My mother is dead, but while she was living, I could never...
Can I say she's not dead, but go on.
Okay, thank you. I felt she was very needy when she was hugging me. She was just needy.
Mm-hmm.
And I could never be angry on her because then she blamed me and told me once, I remember I will...
Are you the eldest daughter?
No.
No?
I have three brothers and three sisters.
How old are they? Can you give me the ages? The oldest?
I'm not really sure about it. But the oldest one, yeah, I can... 67.
67?
Yeah, a brother.
Yep, so that's a boy?
Yeah.
Male? Yep.
Male. Next is 66.
Yep.
A male?
Male.
Next, I think, 64, male.
Male?
Yeah. Next is a sister, and she is 62.
Yep. 62, female?
Yeah. Next, the female is...
58, female.
Yeah, then it's me, 57.
57,
yeah.
Female.
And then it's my younger sister. She's 8 years younger than me, so might be...
49.
Yeah, she's the one I have most female. Problem with. the other ones I have not so much connection, but I don't feel the problem, yeah.
Of course. Mm-hmm. Your mother is a woman you had to take responsibility for.
Yes? Yeah.
Okay. So what's happened is that your mother abdicated her role as a mother.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
And because of the age difference between the two of you, you became the surrogate mother for this person.
I did,
yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
When you become a surrogate parent, you receive all of the projections
of the
sibling that the parent is trying to get away from.
I felt that, yeah.
Makes sense?
Yeah, sure.
And her main causes of anger towards you is that you then became a parent.
Mm.
She then sees you as the parent.
She still sees me as a parent.
Sorry?
She still sees me as a parent.
Yes, yes. Okay. Yeah. Yes, yes. Mm. And will continue to do so until she works through the emotions of loss that she never really had a mother.
Mm.
Does that make sense?
Mm.
So she substituted you in place of her mother because she never really had a mother. And then, of course, you have emotional injuries from your mother too because your mother caused you to look after her.
Mm.
So then you take sort of like a matriarchal role in the family, which is not yours to take, but it's forced upon you.
Mm.
And as a result of that, any injuries you have, then the younger sibling feels a problem with as a result. So it's almost like... So what happens is they start seeing you as the problem rather than seeing their own grief about their mother not being present as a problem.
Yeah, they all project a lot of things on me. And I try to do a lot of things for balancing it. And
You take on the role of the mother.
Yeah, I do. Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And as you disconnect from the role of a mother, you will trigger all of their addictions with their surrogate mother, which is you.
Mm.
So in other words, they would project anger at you, rage at you, and eventually they'll go through all of those feelings and end up with feelings really realizing that all of this is really their mother deserves, not you.
Mm.
But unfortunately, they're going to go through that entire process. Mm. And there's nothing you can do to avoid it. And in some ways, you've taken on the role of a mother and still taken it on. And if you dropped it many, many years ago... then this would have all happened many years ago and it would all be over by now.
Mm.
But it's got to happen at some point where they, and in particular she, realises that you're not her mother.
Mm.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I could see that when I'm not... 2 months ago when I stopped to contact her, I could see it just was so... I was so afraid of her and same time it was... same difficult that I was not taking care of her. I was so afraid that she should really, I think that's also something I felt, I was scared of my mother should do suicide, and I can feel I'm the same for my sister.
Yep. Yeah. And the reality is there is a codependent addiction inside of you of wanting to take care of her. And this is what you need to look at giving up. And this is your opportunity to give it up. You need to work your way through the emotions as to why you're always wanting to take care of your younger sister and take on the role of a mother with her when you're not her mother, right? And the reality is her mother doesn't want to take on the role with her either. And another reality is that you do not want to give up the role very easily because you get certain things out of it when it's working well. So when the role is working well, you get to feel, you know, like you're a loving person, and you get to feel like you're a good person and a good mother and a lot of other emotions. And you need to work your way through giving those up because in the end, you're assisting this surrogacy.
Yeah, I think I start to see it right last time. But what I feel right now is that I have to tell her about this, and I'm so scared about to tell her.
And that's a part of this. So part of your fear is to do with what you'll lose. You know you're going to lose something.
Yeah.
And you're probably going to initially lose her good opinion of you.
Yeah.
And you're very afraid of that. And that's one of your addictions. Mm. And the key is to still tell her the truth and give up that addiction through the process.
I'm afraid of losing her.
You're afraid of, completely.
Yeah.
She may become very... She may become... Well, all the things she needs to do with her mother is what she probably would do with you first until she's worked through the issue, and then she'll realise that a lot of this emotion she had with you really belongs towards her mother, not to you.
I really felt that it's all this anger to me starting when I started taking care about her when she was around 50 and something. My parents were divorcing that time, and it was terrible at home.
Yeah.
And I started to take care about, and after that, it started to come.
Yes,
The anger to me, it wasn't there before.
Again, like most people's anger, it's a anger that is done in substitution.
Yeah,
you know, she doesn't want to be angry with her mother because she wants love from her.
Mm.
Does that make sense? And so she's prepared to be angry with you because she can give up that love. But she doesn't want to give up the idea that her mother didn't love her.
Yeah. You know? And she knows that I'm still coming, even if she's angry at me.
Exactly, so, which is your lack of love of yourself.
Yeah, sure.
And also you need to question why you are in that addiction with her. Why? Mm. And this is something I'd like to say generally about people who are angry. This is something, like I said earlier, that I noticed here in Sweden, is that many people pander or support the actions of an angry person. And we need to stop doing this. Right, because if we keep doing this, we're telling those angry people that they're allowed to be angry, and that angry is going to get them somewhere. Right, and if we always say no, anger is not the answer to this problem. Anger is not going to get you anywhere with me. You're going to have to learn to treat me lovingly and respectfully. Then you'll get somewhere with me. Then we can address and solve some of these problems. But if we only pander to the anger, we only do what the anger demands, all we're teaching them is that anger is good. And they're teaching them that anger is something that they can continue doing for the rest of their life and get away with it. That's what we're teaching.
I have got a lot of anger for many women, so that I'm most difficult with women. So if I look at this with my sisters, will also include a lot of other women, suppose.
The reality is for you, you have a lot of stuff with your mum actually to work your way through because your mum is in a passive-aggressive rage with all of her children, in particular with her daughters.
So
the reality is there is a lot of rage coming from your mother. Her whole wanting to suicide and abdicate her role as a mother is all about rage. Any person who wants to go to suicide is usually very, very angry. And any person who threatens it over and over again in order to control their environment is a very angry person and using it as a tool of control. So you do need to work your way through the things you're afraid of with your mother. So this is a great opportunity to do that, and that will help you relinquish the role and actually will benefit your sister greatly, because then she will have to go through her emotions about her mother just like you have to. And that will benefit. At the moment, she can avoid it by treating you as her mother. And she can avoid a lot of emotions in that place. Not good for her, not good for her life.
I have a big blockage over here, so I suppose it's my grief.
No, for you, it's more about telling the truth, about speaking the truth. You
would be something,
have a big problem with speaking the truth.
That's true.
Yeah, and so you're willing to hold on to the truth without speaking it all of the time. You don't want to tell people what you really feel. Mm. You're constantly holding on to what you really feel without telling it. Mm. And this is a big issue that you face. And if you're not careful, you're going to create some problems in your body in this region, possibly thyroid, or in the neck region, you're going to have continual problems if you're not careful, while you're so resistive to just saying the truth of how you feel.
Okay, thanks a lot.
It's a pleasure. It's actually 10 to 6, so I'm going to stop now, if that's okay with you. I'm a bit tired myself. I know we could probably go all night. I just wanted to say to you, I've just really enjoyed the last couple of days with you as an audience. And I've enjoyed, you know, the questions that you've had, but also being able to discuss those issues about the law of attraction. You wanted to say something rather than ask? I feel in Sweden there are some general feelings that I can feel from you as an audience, where that I can discuss with you briefly if you wish. Would you like that, just rather than specific? Yes? Okay. All right. For many of you ladies, I feel a very strong amount of anger towards men. So, to be frank with you, it will only be men who are conciliatory, who pander, who want to please your anger, who you will attract into your life, right? Because the rest of the men will feel that anger and feel very repulsed by it. They'll feel, rejected and repulsed by it. So I feel generally, for many of you, my lovely sisters here, you need to start looking at why you are so angry with men. And much of it is about your fathers, how your fathers treated you. Many of you are in a lot of denial about how your fathers treated you. And this is a problem. You actually want to believe your fathers, a lot of you want to believe your fathers treated you well when the fathers did not treat you well. Or you want to believe they loved you when you didn't feel loved from them. And these are issues that you need to have a look at if you are going to address specific issues. I don't know if you've noticed here, just have a look down the middle here, down this middle, and then look back and see how many men are on that side. One very brave man. And on this side, how many men do you see on this side? All the other men, other than one. Isn't that very interesting? See, this is telling you as a group that there is a segregation of the gender, of the sexes, and this is a primary emotional injury that you face. To be frank with you, if we had healed our emotional injuries with the opposite gender, there'd be a very even dispersion of men and women in the audience, throughout the audience. Does that make sense? But here, if you draw a line, interestingly, the left side of me is mostly women, which is very interesting because the left side of your body is about the feminine. And the right side of me is a fairly even mixture of men and women. Does that make sense? It's very interesting when you see that, because that is a law of attraction event in itself. So there is this emotion coming from many of you women that you have a good reason to be angry with the men, right? And that is causing you to remain blocked to dealing with the grief you feel about the men. Mary, you would like to mention?
Just wanted to add strong feeling I feel from many of the women is about desire to be strong and never show I might need or want a man. Is sort of, it's not only anger, there's a real pride in strength,
yes,
and a fear of being vulnerable,
yes,
and a feeling that would be weakness to actually open my heart to a man.
Yes, I agree. So does that make sense? So as women, my suggestion for you is to work your way or begin working your way through that issue sincerely. Because it's very easy to be insincere about that issue and go, oh, men have hurt me in the past, so that's why I'm rigid. Well, no, it's not why you're rigid. Do you know the real reason why you're rigid? It's because you don't want to cry about it. You don't want to cry about how men have hurt you in the past. Does that make sense? You don't want to let it go. You don't want to forgive. So there's an issue that's there. Now, what I noticed with many of you guys in the audience is that you are pandering towards women. You do what women want you to do. And this is a problem, because if you continue to do what women want you to do all the time, and women want you to do things that are unloving to yourself or unloving to other people, then you go ahead and do them. And that's not going to be very good for your own soul, right? So what we need to do as men is be able to stand up and be firmer for truth when it comes to issues. And you need to look at your addiction as why you want to please women. And a lot of times that's about getting love from them. Or for many of you, it's getting sex from them, which you interpret as love from them. Do you understand? So we need to address that particular issue as a general group. This is just the group here I'm speaking of, not the general people in Sweden. And if you address those particular issues, then you'll find there'll be an interdispersion of the gender. Right? Does that make sense to everyone? You will actually come in a very, very comfortable and where you sit, it will be very noticeable. There will be a mixture of men and women. And in fact, in the end, in any group, once all of the people have dealt with, or most of the people in the group have dealt with their intergender emotional injuries, you'll find that there will be no segregation of the gender, of the sexes, in any way. You'll even share in, you know, cups of teas down in the chinwag sessions that you might have, the discussion sessions that you might have, down the coffee shop. It won't be exclusively women or exclusively men who go to the pub or exclusively, you know, anybody in terms of a gender. You'll have an inclusive emotion or inclusive feeling. So I feel that's a fairly large issue to address. So for you, my sisters, have a look at those issues related to the men. And for my brothers, just have a look at the underlying emotional reasons why you feel drawn into doing what women want, even when they're angry with you. Right? So there's a fear of their anger. And you're not afraid of getting violently attacked, you know, in terms of hurt physically, but you are afraid of how they'll treat you emotionally. You know, like they say, there's no hell like a woman's scorn. Yes, and some of you feel that you're very, very afraid of that emotional projection, and this is about having courage for the truth rather than actually pandering to a person who's in an angry place. You wanted to say another thing, darling?
Just generally, I felt. There's a strong feeling about desire for control and order, especially yes. around emotion, and a huge fear of the unpredictability and so perceived uncontainability of emotion. What will happen? How will I be perceived? What will happen to me if I just allow emotion?
Yes, there is a lot of society judgment here in Sweden, particularly on two emotions, grief and anger. And this causes a lot of suppression, and it also causes things to be unsuppressed in other areas, other than those two emotions. The key thing to do here is to address those particular issues of allowing your grief, and the judgments you have about why you don't allow it, and look at the reasons why you find anger difficult to express. Not to another person, but just to feel and express. We notice there's a very high level of control in the way you interact with each other. And sometimes you feel quite frustration or annoyance or some other emotions with each other, but you never even voice it, even to yourself almost. It's like you can't even admit that it's happening. And this is obviously something that's been quite engendered into your culture through your family systems. So our suggestion there is to just allow yourself to consider the grief that's inside of you, at least consider that it's present, and to also see the anger that's present and see that much of your actions when you're angry are passive-aggressive. Do you know what I mean by passive-aggressive? Like you're willing to sit there and project the anger, without actually saying anything about it. And you feel that's still polite, and it's not. It's not polite. The polite place would be to actually not have the anger. That would be polite. So we'd just suggest that you maybe have a look at those particular problems. As I said, myself and Mary have enjoyed your company, very much enjoyed your company and your questions. Tomorrow we're headed off to... We won't get much time tonight to talk to people because we've got to pack up some things, and I've got to actually copy off all of the data that we have overnight because it's the last time we'll get to do that for some time. So I won't get to spend much time with you after we stop. So we'd just like to thank you for your attendance and our ability to get to know you and enjoy your company a bit, and thank the people who were involved in also setting up and running this event for us. We would also like to thank you for your donations that you've given to us. And we would also... We're going tomorrow to Vilhelmina and to Helikvale, and so we're going up north, and we'll be spending about a week up there with Eva and Per, who are setting up a learning centre for Sweden. And they're actually going through the process of doing that now. And so we wanted to spend a bit more time with them, talking to them about what would be involved in that kind of a process. So that's where we're going over the next week. And then next Monday we're back to London for a few days. We give a talk there. And then we're off to the USA for a week. And then, as I said yesterday, we go down to Barbados, to Brazil. And we spend 3 weeks in Brazil and then home. So that's our plans for the next few weeks. We won't get to much electronic media over the next week and a half, probably. So we're trying to address a lot of the things tonight when we get home, of all the things we need to address before we leave. You had a question? No worries. I'll write down the details. That's a very good question. I'll do that. So let's do that. Now, we have a office email address, and there's a person in Australia who watches that address. And a lot of times she's capable of answering personal questions. She's a friend of ours, Luli, her name is. She's capable of answering personal questions about different matters or referring you to different talks. So sometimes that's a great way to get some help. So that's the address is office@divinetruth.com. The website that we have is just a very basic website. It's primarily for the distribution of information. So it has all sorts of audios. Every single talk that we do, we record audio and video. So we have audios of talks. There's, I think, around about 300 talks that are on there, audios. A lot of them are 4 hours long, so they take a long time listening. We have around about 270 videos uploaded on YouTube, all for free. They're all for free, so you can download them anytime. And so that's of about 135 of those talks are on YouTube as well. So if I give you the address of the website is www.divinetruth.com. And the YouTube location, you can actually go to the website, and if you look at, there's a welcome page, and if you click on the welcome page, there will be in the list, there will be a link to for first-time visitors of videos, and if you click on the video link, it'll jump you straight to YouTube. And it will go to a playlist in YouTube, and it lists off all of the different videos that are there. But if you want to go to there directly or search it in YouTube, it's called, on YouTube, it's called the Divine Truth Channel. Now, all the people that help us for free, just like we give all of these things for free, all the people who help us do things for free, doing things for free as well. Now, there's some people at home who are full-time doing things for free for people. And those particular people we have listed on the website under the donations page. If you would like to donate to them, feel free to do so on those pages. Because there are a couple in Australia who do all of our video editing and all of our audio editing, as you can imagine it. And myself and Mary, when we get going, we produce a lot of material, and it takes quite a long time for them to do it. Like I said, they volunteer their time full time to do that. And they are completely dependent on donations. They get very little funds in comparison from ourselves, because all of our funds generally go on distributing more information as well. So that's how all of the people who help us live. They live via donations as well. So feel free to donate to them if you desire to. There's no requirement. Everything that we do is for free. And we also distribute, as I said, a disc. We're currently copying for a few different people a disc drive. Anna has a disc drive, which will be a copy, an up-to-date copy of all of the things we've currently mastered. And so if you would like to have a copy of every single thing that's on YouTube and every single thing that's on our website, you can actually get a 500 gigabyte disc. And I think they'll cost around, in Australia they cost about $90, so here they'd probably cost about 450 kroner. Oh, okay. Depends what size. If it was a 500, it would probably... it's about 800 kroner for a 500 gig disc, is it? Yeah. Right. So if you send the disc to Anna, she will copy all of the material for you and send it back to you for free. And again, that's Anna's time, so you just be honor Anna's time. We also have at home, we have a service where we send anywhere in the world USB memory sticks that are 16 gigabytes of movies and anything that you want to download. So we can actually put the entire website plus about 8 movies on that little stick. So if you have only specific movies you'd like to order, you can email, and the girls and the guys in Australia will put it all together and send you back via snail mail, the slow way, the information. Other than that, it's all available here. You have quite fast internet links here, it seems, and so you'll probably find watching it on YouTube is one of the better ways for you to see the information. Yep. Is there anything else that you can think of, babe? That you've turned it off. Have you? Oh, yes. Do you want to take a photo? Yes. Would you like to have a photo? Those of you who want to be part of the photo, as soon as we finish, if you come up here and arrange yourself, we'll move this out of the way. We'll take some photos of you. Sorry? Or in the sun. Would you like to do it in the sun?
Yes.
Because in the sun sometimes is a bit sort of glary. One here, one there, whatever. I'll leave that for you to organise. And thank you very much, guys, for your time. Thank you. And we don't know when we'll see you again. So we wish you the best, and hope that you enjoy embracing your relationship with God and with each other. Oh, yes. People in Australia wanted us to bring to express their love for you. They now have met many of you from the last videos we took. So now when we say Anna or, you know, whatever, they know, they can remember your faces. And so they just wanted to express their love for you and your their thanks for you sharing your faces on the videos for them, for a change. We will do. Thank you very much. Okay. See you later then.